Can the church family say amen? You guys did great. All right. I'm just as nervous. It's okay. The future church right there. I'll say it's a happy Sabbath. God is rejoicing in heaven with his angels. His future church is here and now. This ministry of adventurers and pathfinders is part of my testimony as to why I'm here today. Let us say a word of prayer. Father, these are your truths. This is your message. These are your people. Speak through your servant today. Let your Holy Spirit touch these hearts and minds, Lord, that we may understand your promises. In Christ's name, amen. I got a little clicker here somewhere. All right. There we go. Today's reading, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." I think when Paul was writing this to the early church, when he was forming this letter to the Church of Romans, to those believers there, he had come to this conclusion looking at the promise of God. So I asked myself, have I ever really stopped to think of what a promise really is? Why do we make promises? Who do we make promises to? Do we keep those promises? When was the first promise ever made? Has that promise been kept? Who made it? To whom was it made? Do we have any proof? I think this is what Paul was thinking when he was talking to the church. So here we go, right? Quick Google search. Here's a definition. Oxford Dictionary. Gotta remind myself, clicker here. A promise is a declaration or assurance that something, or that one will do a particular thing, or that a particular thing will happen. When used as a verb, it's assuring somebody that one will definitely do, give, or arrange something, to undertake or declare that something will happen. I kept it positive, right? The converse can also be true. But this made me think of all the promises I have made in my life. Okay? I came up with the big three. Okay? So I'm a physician, so I took an oath. I'm a naval officer. So I took an oath of office there as well. And the most important one is I've been married for 10 and a half years, and I have marriage vows. And that is an oath as well. So here we go. I just wanted to look at these. And the most important one is the foundation, as you can clearly see. So it says here, when I took my Hippocratic oath, I highlighted the part I wanted to focus on. It's really long, but it says, "I'll respect the privacy of my patients, for their problems are not disclosed to me that the world may know." I think all of my patients appreciate that I made a promise to them saying that I wouldn't talk to anybody else about what they're disclosing to me. Similarly, I took an oath to be a commissioned officer, and I raised my right hand and I said that I do affirm that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and that I bear true faith and allegiance to the same. Not trying to sway a person one way or another, but I take those two extremely serious. They're my profession. They're what I do. More importantly, I said I take Miranda to be my wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for richer or for poor, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish all the days of my life. Now, those three are about 10 to 12 years old, all right? During that time, have I been able to say, wait, hold on, I need a break. Who can I sub in? Can somebody take my place? Can somebody be a doctor for me? I just need a break. Or as a commissioned officer, wait, hold on, not today. I don't think I can keep that promise. Or more importantly, Ben, Olivia, I'm gonna take Ben, and then, you know, I need a break. No, it doesn't work that way, right? All of our promises are ours to keep. There are no substitutions. It's 24/7, 365 days, no timeouts, no breaks. If we make promises, we should do what? We should keep them. Now, I'll be the first to admit, I have not kept all my promises, and I have not been the best at keeping promises. I think my kids and my wife would attest to that. There's this thing called a honey-do list, right? We make these promises, like, I'm gonna get to that, honey. Yes, I will do that for you. And then you say it one more time, like, yep, I'm gonna get to that as well. And eventually it becomes the when did you say you were gonna do that for me? Or with the kids, during the week, with work and school, it's like, yes, I'm gonna sit down with you and we're gonna get to build this together. And we're going to spend some quality time together. We're gonna garden together, we're gonna do some yard work, we're gonna spend quality time together. And then other things come up and there's four or five things to do that day and we don't get to all of them. But then there's this thing that we do, which is kind of the continuation of a promise. Like, buddy, we couldn't do that today, but we'll get to that. It's going to be the first thing next on the list. So no, by no means have I been able to keep all my promises. These three are the ones that keep in the forefront of my mind and every day renew, along with my dedication to my Heavenly Father. But that brings us to the next thing. When was the first promise ever made? We look at Earth's history. That first promise was a promise between God and man. But why did God have to make this promise? Was it a promise out of necessity? Yes. Was it because something happened? Yep. And why did that happen? How do we know that God kept it? We're going to look at all of these things, but to answer this, we got to go back in time. I know a lot of you guys are thinking we're going to go back to Genesis. Nope, we're not going to go back to Genesis. We got to go a little farther back. In the Bible, it actually doesn't tell us how far back this actually happened, when it happened, but we know that it did happen because the Bible talks about it. It says in Ezekiel, "You were the anointed cherub who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created till iniquity was found in you." Ezekiel 28, verses 14 and 15. So this is about somebody who God created, an angel it sounds like, right? And this angel was created with a fault. Is that what it says? He was created perfect. If you came yesterday, he had an amazing presentation. And one of the things that he touched on is one that I'm going to touch on again today. Nope, I didn't call him. This was divine intervention here. Because one of the biggest things that we see that this person tells us is no, there was a fault. And it is somebody's fault. And the answer is no. He was created perfect. The Bible continues to tell us in Isaiah that this person says, "For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit on the mount of congregation on the farthest side of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the cloud, and I will be like the Most High. So this person clearly had aspirations, right? Now, this person was coveting another's position, right? And I think we all know this story, but I wanted to show it from the Bible and how the Bible tells it, that this angel was the covering cherub, was constantly in the presence of God, but then started to have these thoughts, started to build. And we kind of have to supplement this here. And I looked into it and I was like, well, if one of the things that he says all the time or tells us or tries to make us think is that this is because of God or God did this, let's look at how great and merciful and patient our Heavenly Father is. Patriarchs and Prophets says that in great mercy, according to his divine character, God bore long with Lucifer. The spirit of discontent and disaffection had never before been known in heaven. It was a new element, strange, mysterious, and unaccountable. Lucifer himself had not at first been acquainted with the real nature of his feelings. For a time, he feared to express the workings and imaginings of his mind, yet he did not dismiss them. He did not see whither he was drifting. But such efforts as infinite love and wisdom can only devise, were made to convince him of his error. His disaffection was proved to be without cause, and he was made to see what would be the result of persisting in revolt. Lucifer was convinced that he was in the wrong, that the Lord is righteous in all his ways and holy in all his works, that the divine statutes are just, and that he ought to acknowledge them as such before heaven. Had he done this, he might have saved himself and many angels. He had not at the time fully cast off his allegiances to God, though he had left his position as the covering cherub. Yet, if he had been willing to return to God, acknowledge the Creator's wisdom, and satisfied to fill the place appointed to him in God's great plan, he would have been reinstated in his office. The time had come for a final decision. We don't know how long it took, but we're eternally grateful. I am eternally grateful for God's patience with us. He gives each and every single one of us time to come to him. He doesn't say we have to come to him perfect. He just says, come, let's reason. He did that with Lucifer. As we can clearly see, it was something that needed to be understood. And he was shown that if he persisted, this would happen. God is good with his patience towards his people. It says here, Lucifer made his decision, and we know how that went. He chose to revolt. He not only chose to revolt, he chose to tell others and say, you know what? I don't agree with this. So in his thinking, he now brought into question and was vocal about it. So first in his heart, as the Bible says, and then what? Then with his actions. And then he was like, you know, if I can convince others, God has created worlds. I could go to them as well. So we clearly see that it says that God's government included not only the inhabitants of heaven, but all the worlds that he had created. And Lucifer concluded that if he could carry the angels of heaven with him in rebellion, he could also do this in the worlds. So ultimately, there came a point. Clearly, there were two sides. There were those that stuck with God and his character and his government and said, nope, this isn't right. And then there were those that were deceived that he had brought to his side. And clearly, we can see in Revelation where it says, "And war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon and his angels fought. But they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, the serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him." Okay. So this happened long ago. We don't know when. We don't know how long. But before the creation of the world, we know that this happened. God created Lucifer perfect, correct? He created him perfect. Then he chose to walk away from God in his station as the covering cherub. He then chose in his heart to rebel and in his actions to rebel and led others to rebel against God. And war broke out and he was cast out. So that's it, right? We're done? That's the end of the story, guys? No. So then, as we read, he knew that he had other places that he could go. And we can see his thought process here. In Patriarchs and Prophets, it says, "It was his policy to perplex with subtle arguments concerning the purposes of God. Everything that was simple, he shrouded in mystery by artful perversion, cast doubt upon the plainest statements of Jehovah. And his high position, so closely connected to the divine government, gave greater force for his representations." What I take this as, he knew and had been in the presence of God. He was the covering cherub. He knew the government of God. It says he was convicted that he was incorrect, he was wrong, that God was just, and he chose to rebel. So now, to get those to go to his side, he had to twist a little the simple truths of Jehovah. It doesn't get any simpler than God is love. It doesn't get any simpler than he died for us first. It doesn't get any simpler than I accept you as you are. However, he does something. If we look at today, you can do any search, any media. You look at things today, and everything just casts doubt. Doubt in everyone and everything. I'm not excluded. We have this saying in the military, trust but. All right, it's not only in the military. Trust but verify. Is that trust? No, that's doubt. We doubt everyone and everything in today's day and age. We don't believe anybody has any good intentions anymore. No one can be trusted. Only look to yourself. The devil was doing everything he could to make people forget God's government, his character, his grace, his love. And he took it to other worlds. It says, "Since that time, Satan and his army of confederates have been avowed enemies of God in our world." Why our world? We're going to get to that. "Continually warring against the cause of truth and righteousness. Satan became the avowed antagonist of Christ. On earth, he planted his standard of rebellion and round it his sympathizers. And he was looking to add more followers to his cause." To understand the need of the first promise, we must realize that there is a great controversy between God and Satan. He doesn't want us to realize this, because if we do not have this truth and we do not know this truth, everything else will not fit. The pastor's been going over the armor of God. And what is the first piece of the armor of God? The belt of truth. The way I see it is, hey, my belt kind of keeps everything how it is. In those days, their belt ensured that that breastplate kind of fit properly, that everything else kind of fit. The truth is the foundation. And if we are not convinced that there is a great controversy, then we cannot see the need of a first promise. Enter humanity stage right, right? So now we come into the picture. And again, the Bible isn't clear on the timeline of the point of the rebellion and the start of the great controversy between God and Satan, but we do know that at some point it came here, right? In Genesis chapter 1, now we can go to Genesis chapter 1. Let's all turn there. Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1 is filled with truths. Filled with many truths in those first 31 verses of the Bible. Yesterday, he did a fantastic job going over this, and this is kind of the truth I want to focus on. But it says, in the beginning, God did what? God created, right? And then it goes to say that God created in how many days? 6 days, not 6 millennia. Not 600 million years, in 6 days he created. And it said he created everything. And then it says he established a day of rest, the seventh day, the Sabbath. And it goes on to say that he created man in whose image? His image. Wait. So that thing that we're taught in school about, you know, sludge and... No. It says, we were created in the image of God, and God created man. And the one I want to focus on is the quality of work, right? 7 times in Genesis chapter 1, it says something. 6 times it says it one way, and the 7th, it emphasizes how well it was done. It says, Genesis chapter 1, verse 4 says, and God saw the light, and it was good. Verse 10 says, and God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And in verse 12, and God saw that it was good. In verse 18, and God saw that it was good. In verse 21, and God saw that it was good. And again, in verse 25, it says, and God saw that it was good. And then after creating man and seeing creation complete, in verse 31, it says, then God saw everything he had made, and indeed it was very good. We have to be certain that we know that God is good. And God and everything that he does is good. And if everything that he made was good, then where did the bad stuff come from? Remember what it said, those simple truths. He put doubt in our minds on these simple truths that God has given us. In Genesis chapter 2, we kind of see a glimpse of perfection. Man is in Eden, naming the animals over his dominion, over creation, walking with God, being taught by his creator. But then in chapter 3, here's where we see why that first promise was needed. When we look at the creation story through the lens of the great controversy, we can clearly see that evil did not originate in God's creation. It came from someone else. And we read in Genesis, let's turn to Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 6, it says, so when woman saw the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of the fruit and ate. She also gave it to her husband with her, and he ate. Patriarchs and Prophets says, at creation, Adam was placed in dominion over the earth. But by yielding to temptation, he was brought under the power of Satan. Of whom a man is overcome, of the same he is brought in bondage. When man became Satan's captive, the dominion which he held passed to his conqueror. Thus Satan became the god of this world. He had usurped the dominion over the earth, which had originally been given to Adam. But that's not the end of the story either. Man fell and lost his dominion over the earth, but God would not give up his beloved creation so quickly. Continues to say that, but divine love had conceived a plan whereby man might be redeemed. The broken law of God demanded the life of the sinner. In all the universe, there was but one who could, in behalf of man, satisfy its claim. Since the divine is as sacred as God himself, only one equal to God could make the atonement for its transgression. None but Christ could redeem the fallen man from the curse of the law and bring him again into harmony with heaven. Christ would take upon himself the guilt and the shame of sin. Sin so offensive that it to a holy God that it must separate the Father and his Son. God had a plan. He had a promise that he would make. And we read of that promise in Genesis 3, verse 15. Let's turn to Genesis 3, verse 15. Right there it says, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. As soon as there was sin, there was a Savior. I'm going to say that again. As soon as there was sin, there was a Savior. Christ knew that he would have to suffer, yet he became man's substitute. As soon as Adam had sinned, the Son of God presented himself as surety, as the promise for the human race, with just as much power to avert doom pronounced upon the guilt as when he died upon the cross of Calvary. Right then and there, Christ said, Father, look at me. I am enough. Right then and there, when he made that promise, Adam and Eve no longer had to pay that penalty. They had a substitute in Christ. Here's another one for you. You're not good enough. You got to wait. Get better. Get better. Everything you do, you got to be, you're not good enough. He's not going to accept you. He's just not going to accept you where you are. You just got to keep getting better. Is that what this says? As soon as there was sin, there was a Savior. As soon as Adam and Eve fell, they had no part in this. Christ says, I am here. I take their place, Father. Look at me. The other way. But now we can clearly see that it still wasn't over. He now had gained ground. He had dominion over this world. And we can see that when he heard that enmity would exist, when Satan heard enmity would exist or should exist between himself and the woman and between his seed and her seed, he knew that his work of depriving human nature would be interrupted, that by some means man would be enabled to resist his power. Yet, as the plan of salvation was more fully unfolded, Satan rejoiced with his angels that having caused man's fall, he could bring down the Son of God from his exalted position. He declared that his plan was thus far been successful upon the earth, and that when Christ should take upon himself human nature, he also might be overcome, and thus the redemption of the fallen race might be prevented. So he thought, hey, this is going my way. This is perfect. I got this. But what he didn't know at the time of the fall, and what he didn't know throughout the entire Old Testament, what he did not know until Jesus himself proclaimed it, was that nothing could separate God from keeping his promise. Adam and Eve, they believed in this promise. They believed that Christ would come. They knew God's government. They knew of his love. And they chose to accept Christ as their Savior. I think up to this point, many of you are somewhat confused. Like, wait, is this about the great controversy, or is this about God's promises? But I promise you, okay, it's going to come full circle. We're going to see here that to understand God's promises, we have to understand the great controversy. It says that the Old and the New Testament are referred to as the two witnesses in Revelation. Both are important testimonies of the origin and perpetuity of the law of God. Both witness to the plan of salvation. It says the types, sacrifices, and prophecies of the Old Testament point towards a Savior to come. And the gospel and the epistles of the New Testament tell of a Savior who has come in the exact manner foretold by those types and prophecies. Did God keep his promise? God has kept his promise. We need to understand that every promise that God gave us in his word is connected to the first promise ever made. And that the great controversy is a witness unto this promise. Within its books, within its chapters, we find countless testimonies of how God has kept his promise, and that this great controversy continues even to today. So I just have three examples that I want to give and share. These are found within the first 10 chapters of Genesis. It's important for us to understand, and it's important for us to share with one another, as well as with our children, that these stories are more than just stories. They point towards something. They mean something more. And when you look at it through the lens of the great controversy, it tells you of a promise, and a promise fulfilled. So we look at the story of Cain and Abel, story well known. The Bible says that Abel was counted for righteousness. Why was that? Because he believed in this promise, and he gave as was indicated. He accepted the promise sacrifice that would come. Now, his brother, he had a similar thing, and we see this again. He also was like, well, no, maybe my way is better. In him, in his mind, and then in his actions, he chose to walk away from God. He chose not to do the things that God had said to do. And then it was brought to his attention. But instead of correcting it, the Bible says, Cain was of the wicked one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his works were evil and his brother's were righteous. He chose a side. And in choosing that side, he allowed somebody else to work through him. And he killed his brother. Why did he kill his brother? Because by accepting the promise of the Savior, he had been identified, Abel had been identified as the one through whom the seed would come. So the devil was like, you know what? I can end it here. I can kill off Abel and kill off the promise of the seed. But he couldn't do that. Because the Bible says, and Adam knew his wife again, and she bore a son and named him Seth. For God had appointed another seed for me instead of Abel, who Cain killed. So God would not allow that promise to die with Abel. And then we see again, well, I can't kill them off. So then I'm going to ensure that I make them forget who God is. And when Cain walked away from the Lord, we can clearly see that the devil began to add to his ranks. Because when we walk away from the presence of God, the Bible's clear that those who walk according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, and to be carnally minded is enmity against God. Two clear sides are made. Now he mixes the two. It's like, I'm going to bring my side to their side. And we can see that the sons of Seth met the daughters of Cain. Hello. And then they mix together. To the point where it became indistinguishable that there had ever been good. And the Bible clearly shows that in Genesis when we're talking about the flood. It says that humanity had gotten to the point where their thoughts were nothing but continually evil. The earth was so corrupt, the earth was filled with violence. God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had been corrupted in their ways. So the devil felt like, I won. Now they're not going to know there ever was a God. One thing the devil cannot do that God does do is look at the heart. And God, looking through that generation, looking at the heart of man, found one. For the Bible says that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Again, he may tell you you are a certain way, but God looks at your heart. God looks at your heart. So that brings us to the last one, unbroken lineage or genealogy, right? The unbroken lineage. In Genesis, again, we clearly see that from Adam, there came through Noah. And then in Genesis 11, we see that through the line of Noah, we get to Abram. And if we were to continue, and I could continue on for probably another hour, church. If we were to continue on and look in every period of time, there are stories in the Bible that speak of this great controversy and God keeping his promise for us. And we get to the end of the Old Testament. And as soon as we hit Matthew, we find in Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. It says, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Throughout the Old Testament, that line was not broken. However many times the devil tried, he could not break the line of Christ. He could not break the line of the seed to come. Jesus, when he was on earth, he continually would remind his followers through his parables, through the plain conversations that he had, that he was the one who made the promise in Eden and had come to keep it. He had a conversation with Nicodemus in John chapter 3, and we can clearly see that he reminded him of the story of the serpent in the wilderness and then told him, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." And up until his last breath on Calvary, he said, "It is finished." God kept his promise, church. And there was nothing that the devil can do to separate us from the love of God. And all we have to do is what? Believe. So when Paul is talking to the church in Romans, and he is saying this, that he is persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing, which Lucifer is, shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. He was looking, church, at the great controversy. He was looking at that first promise. He was looking at the life of Christ, and he was looking at how God had kept his promise to his people. Quickly, if we turn to Romans chapter 1, we can see that Paul was convinced of this truth. Romans chapter 1 and verses 1 through 5. It says that Paul, bondservant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scripture, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, whom was born of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom you are also called of Jesus Christ. He was sharing this message, these truths, these simple truths and promises that God had for his people. God kept his promise to his early church. God continues to keep his promise today, church. And we have to believe this and have faith that the part that Christ said, he fulfilled his promise, and then he did what? Like when I gave my kids a promise, not because I couldn't fulfill or because I couldn't fulfill my promise at the time, Christ fulfilled his promise, then he gave another one. He said, "I am going to come back so that where I am, who may be also? We may be also." Paul knew that Christ had fulfilled his promise. He wanted to share it with the church. Wherever we are in our walks, whatever it is that we have issues struggling with, believing in, not only does the Word of God declare his promises, today the world in its current state still proclaims God's promise. And I'm going to show you that. We all know the story of the flood. God gave a promise then, and he said, "Never again will I destroy the earth with a flood." And he gave a promise. And that promise was the rainbow. But what if I told you that every time you saw a rainbow, you could also see it in a completely different aspect, in another aspect? They're tied together. But even if you question that promise, how about this one? Patriarchs and Prophets says that when man, by his great wickedness, invites divine judgment, the Savior intercedes with the Father on his behalf. He points towards the bow in the clouds, the rainbow around the throne, and above his own head as a token of the mercy of God towards repentant sinners. That is a sign that God kept his promise. Church, that is a sign that God kept his promise. He came, he died, he redeemed us. We've been bought back, church. And there is nothing, absolutely nothing, that the devil or anybody else can do to keep you or me from God and his love for us. Today, church, today is the day of our salvation. Today we have the choice to choose if we believe that there is a great controversy, to choose if we believe that there is a first promise. And my hope today is that we choose to believe in these promises and choose to believe that God has kept his promises.
We're going to have our last song. We're going to invite everybody to sing along. We're going to stand up. We're going to have a video, and we're just all going to sing along. All the adventurers are going to come up just to sing along, standing on the promises.
Promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior.
Eternally grateful because you came, you died, you kept your promises. And Lord, we are standing on those promises that you gave us, knowing that nothing, nothing can touch us, Lord. We praise your name, Jesus, and we thank you for your words. We thank you for your promise. Amen.